Hi guys, I got a question a few months back from my favorite German light waver pet from rendering. And I didn't really, I knew it was possible, but I didn't really have a chance to flesh it out, the total effect. But he asked me how this could be replicated in Lightwave, and you can do it actually pretty well. It's not exact, but it's real, real close. And it's close enough that you could probably get away with it and you wouldn't know the difference. So I'm only going to show you one variation of this, but I've gone through and replicated all of these effects, but it would just take too long to do it all. So I'm going to do this one here, or something similar to this one here. But the idea is just to give you an idea of how to go about doing something like this. So this is the one we're going to do, or something similar to this. And like I said, I'm just doing a simplistic version of it just to give you an idea. But there's actually a whole lot that's possible with this. And we can get real, real, real close to replicating this in Lightwave. So let's just get started. So all I have here is this low res head, and it could be more detailed than this. I wasn't going to model it myself. This is the only one I could find that was about the right resolution. So I'm sending out the layout. Now what I'm going to do is I'm just going to add a collision object on it. So effects, collision, and I'm going to turn no shift on and turn it to stick. Now I'm just changing the settings here. I'm going to up the resolution here. It'll be faster to work with. And I'm also changing the way it updates so it doesn't bog down on me at all. So now the next thing I'm going to do here is I'm just going to add a wind. And the reason we're doing this is because we need a force that will pull everything toward the mesh. We have the collision on stick, but what I found is that you need more than that to get this to work properly. What we need is a force that's going to pull everything toward the mesh. So I'm going to add node texture to the direction of this wind. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to use nearest point and point info to get the normals of the nearest point. And this will kind of give it an effect of where the particles will be pulled to the closest point in the direction of the point's normal. So I'm just going to select in the mesh, and I'm getting the index into the point, and then I'm getting the normal, and I'm just making a negative 100% so that it's not pushing out, it's sucking toward the points. So you'll actually get to see the effect this has in a second, because I make a mistake. I forgot to put the win on the fall off to off. So it's not going to work properly, but you'll see what it does because of that. So what I'm doing here is I'm just adjusting the size of the emitter, and this is kind of an important aspect of it. The way I fiddled with these settings a lot, so this is something you're going to have to play with for your individual case. But I think the best thing I found is that you want your emitter to be as big as your biggest particle is. And I found that that gives the best results. Now, I'm using particles that are all the same size, but you don't have to. I'm just doing it because it looks better for this effect, I felt like. But you can use different size particles. You can even use more than one emitter, or more than one emitter that are right on top of one another. So you can have one emitter emitting one size, and then another emitter emitting another size. And that's kind of how you would go about replicating some of that effect that's in that video. But for now, I'm just setting these, so it just looks like this. And you want to take it as close as you can get. Remember, I have it on no shift, so it's not going to calculate the radius with the collision geometry. So I'm just trying to line it up nice. Then I'm going to bring it in as close as I can. So that's pretty good. So the next thing I'm going to do here is just turn this to zero so they last for the whole animation. Show size, output size. I'm going to make the particle size 0.1 and particle resistance 3. Parent motion off, that really doesn't matter in this case. And then the interaction, this is important. I'm setting it to push and I'm putting the force on 400. So now you'll see, when I calculate this, you'll see the error I get because the wind isn't, the fall off isn't set properly. And you'll notice that even though it's on stick, because there's such a force being pushed, it's pushing them off of the mesh. It takes me a minute to figure out why it's doing that, because I didn't realize I didn't have the wind set up properly. So I'm just trying to figure out what's not right here. This wants to be set to frame. I'm doing 12 per frame. I found that that gave me the good enough results for this particles this size. And I'm up in the limit to 12,000. But you'll see that still didn't fix my issue. But you'll see what that wind is doing now in a second. And it's also important that wind is set to heavy wind, because that has a different, reacts differently with the particles and the fall off mode to off. So now you'll see when I calculate this, this is the effect we get. So that's part of the effect. There's a little bit more we want to deal with. I adjust these settings for a little while just to get them just right. This is all stuff that you're going to have to play with on your own to get it exactly the way you want it. So now I'm just trying to get this just right. Like I said, I had already played with these settings, so I kind of had a good idea of where it needed to be. But it did take me a little while to figure out how to get this to look the way that I wanted it to. But I mean, this will give you a really good starting point of where you can start from, because these settings will work. So, but I mean, you can make adjustments to get it to flow the way you want it to flow. So now what I'm doing here is I'm adding another wind, and I'm using this to make it so, because if you just do it like this, and I'm setting this one to add because this one has to react differently, and the fall off to off, and I'm just using a procedural texture turbulence, because if you don't add this, they will just be circles. They'll emit as big circles, and we want to have some distortion to that. We don't want them to just be a big round blob. We want there to be some kind of dynamic motion to it. So now you'll see, because I added that other wind in, it's not going to just grow into a big circle. It'll start to get misshapen. And you'll see more when I let it calculate further. Now I'm still playing with the settings. And like I said, I did replicate pretty much all of those effects that were in that video. And you can do them pretty much exact. I mean, there is slight differences in the collision, but it's marginal. So now what I'm doing here is I duplicated that emitter, and I'm going to put it somewhere else on the face. Now I'm just moving it into position here. So we want it to be the same thing as the other one, basically. So now I'll calculate that. Another thing to mention is this head is fairly big. It's about 50 meters. I found that the bigger it is, the better off you are. I would keep it in that range, whatever your object is. The Lightwave's physics calculation seems to like it better that way. When I had it too small, I was getting particles that were falling through the mesh. But once I made it larger, I had much better luck. So I'm just going to calculate these particles here. I don't make you wait through the whole thing. I pause it in about a second. So here's what we ended up with. And you'll notice that they're not circle anymore, because that's because of that second wind that I added. I thought that was very important to getting this to look better. So this is what we ended up with. And what I'm going to do here is this is where I saving out the file. And I'm just going to call this pre-bake, because this is going to be like my setup file for the particles. And then I'm just going to save it again, save as. I'm going to call this one post-bake. And now what I'm going to do is I'm just going to save all selected motion. So what this will do is it'll save both of those down to one PFX file. So that's all I'm doing there. Let's save the motion of both of them into one. So now I could delete all that, because I have my particles saved out. And I can also take the collision off. So now what I'll do here is I'm going to create another emitter. And I'm just going to load that file up. And that'll give us these particles again. But it's all in one file now. Just easier to work with that way. So what I'm going to do here now is we can't use the normals off of this mesh because it's not detailed enough. And if we were to just try and pull the normals right off of this mesh, we would get severe jumping. And we don't want that. So what we're going to do here is I'm going to use the particle info, and I'm going to have it set to nearest. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to say any points on this mesh that are within certain distance of these particles, I'm going to displace them on their normals. So you'll see the effect that this is giving me. So I'm just going to say the distance to the particle is greater than 1 meter. Then I'm going to displace them along the normals 10 meters. And you'll see that gives me this. And like I said, I'm only using this as a selection, so I can easily select these points and in Modeler. So all I'm going to do now that I have that is I'm going to save that as an endomorph. And I'm just going to save it as needed points. And I'm saving everything, and I'm just turning it off because I only need that to make my selection easily. And I mean, I could have just subdivided the whole head here, but if you're not using the whole head, it's not worth doing it, because you don't want the geometry, you don't need to. You don't want to have all that geometry if you don't need it. So they're the polys that I need. And so I'm just going to copy them, put them in a new layer, So now what I'm going to do is I'm just going to hit tab to subdivide this. And my subdivision is set to 5. I think I show you that here. Yeah. So if I hit tab and then I hit control D, that'll freeze it. So now I have, this will give me much better normals to pull from. Because like I said, if I was trying to pull the normals from that dense mesh, I wouldn't have gotten, it wouldn't have been clean. My rotation wouldn't have been clean. So now all I did in this layer was create a box 1 meter by 1 meter. It doesn't really matter the size. We can deal with the size in the instancer. So it's just a box 1 meter by 1 meter. And like I said, this could be anything, any shape you wanted. If you look at that video in the beginning, that'll give you some other ideas of stuff you can do. But I just wanted to do this as simple as possible because I wanted to try and keep this under a half hour. So now I'm just moving it so that the pivot is at that location. So that's all I need to do there. So I have the box, that refined mesh with the more points, and then the base mesh. So now, just going to go in. I don't need that layer showing or rendering, so I'm just going to hide it and make sure it doesn't show in the viewport. That's that heavy mesh, the dense mesh. So now I'm going to output size, which isn't really necessary here, but I'm doing it. I'll explain what that does in a minute. That'll make it so that the instances automatically get scaled down to the size that was the particle size, which I don't use here. So I'm just copying the instance number to the particles. So now there's all the instances. I added that box, as you see. But they're not aligned to the normals here, which is what we need to do to make this effect work properly. And there's a couple different ways we can do this. In this version, I just used the point rotation, but you could also use the normal and create your own matrix, your own transformation matrix. And for the one where the boxes were laying down flat, that's how you'd want to do it. But for this effect, the point normal, I mean, the point rotation works just fine. So I'm just getting the nearest point and point info, and I'm selecting that dense mesh. So I'm just going to get the index of the nearest point. I'm going to go into the point info. So now I can get the world rotation of the point. So you'll see if I go into the rotation, it'll automatically just snap it to the rotation. And this is the easiest way to go about this, and for this effect it works fine. And you can also, if you wanted, you could randomize the bank. I didn't do that here. They're all the banks are the same in this, but you could all just add to that rotation on the bank. So now what I'm doing here is I want to, you'll notice that the ones in the center are a little bit closer together than the ones that are further out, and that's just the way that lightwave particles collisions work. So now you'll see once I go into the scaling, it overrides the particle rotation or the particle scale of it. So now it's not using the particle scale anymore, it's actually using whatever scale I put into this, into the nodal scaling. It's not using the scale from the particle. So I'm going to set this emitter onto emitter. It's on nearest. So now what I can do here is I can use the age of the particle to actually determine. So I'm going to go from 0 to 30 seconds. And at 0, where they're in the center, closer to the center where they're being born, I want them to be a little smaller. And you could get away with not doing this. You could just make them all a little bit smaller. And I even noticed on the I don't know what app that animation was done from in the beginning, but even theirs in the center, they were a little denser than they were on the outside. So all I'm doing here is I'm saying that when the birth rate's at 0, I want them to be 1 scale. Or when the birth age, when the age is at 0, I want them to be at 1 scale. And then when the age is at 30 seconds or toward the end of the animation, I want them to be at a bigger scale. So that's all that does there. And you can see now our separation is a little bit better. Like I said, you could have just made them all a little bit smaller and that would have worked as well, but I think this looks a little better. So now what I'm doing here is I'm just going to make vector. Tools, make vector. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to use that for the scale of the for the X and the Y, but the Z, I'm going to use that a procedural. And like I said, there's a million different ways that you could go about animating this. I'm just doing this as quickly as possible because I wanted to do this for a while, but I haven't had time to get to it. But I was working on another project that involved a similar effect, so I was able to refine this much better. So I wanted to make this for Peter because I knew it was possible, and I meant to make this tutorial a long time ago, but never got around to it. So now all I'm doing is I'm going to turn this procedural on and off. So I'm just going to, for the background color, I'm using the same scale as the other two, the X and the Y. And then for the foreground color, I'm just going to use a scaler, and I'm going to just ramp it up and down. So you'll see in a second what I'm getting at here. And like I said, if you could spend a lot more time on this and refine this effect a lot. Like I said, I tested this a lot before the tutorial. So I did do most of those effects that were in the original video that I showed you. So they're all possible for the most part. All those effects that were in that video, even the ones with the different size particles, that's all possible to do. So now I'm just going to ramp it from the small amount to a big amount. So I'm just trying to mess with these keys. This isn't really even important. I'm just trying to make something here that kind of replicates the effect that was shown in that video. So now I'm just going to put a key there, and then I'm just going to repeat this. So that's all I'm going to do for the animation. And like I said, there's so much that can be done with this effect. I could never begin to show you everything you could do. I'm just trying to give you the basics of how this can be done. One thing I should have done was probably animated the position of the procedural, because now it's just in the same spot over and over. Whereas if I would have animated it, it would have been different each time it came back. But it really, there's just so many different ways you could go with this. Like I said, you could use different size particles like they did in their vids. There's so many different things. So I'm just going to show you one thing we could do quickly with the textures, just to do something with the texturing. So I'm just going to go into the surface editor, open the nodes. I'm just going to get instance generator. And I can get the scaling. So I just said DB and W, color corrector, and then I can get the Z scale, and I can texture these based on the Z scale of our instances. So like I said, there really is a ton of options in what you can do with the texturing too. A whole lot of things you can do with the texturing. So now I'm just using the Z scale to change the hue. I'm turning on a dome light. And you'll see it gives us this. Now it's multiplying by zero, so it's not going to scale's not going to do nothing now, but you'll see as I up the multiplier, the ones that are scaled more, will the hue will get shifted more. And then when they get scaled down to zero again, you'll see they'll all go to zero. And like I said, this is just one of a million different things you could do in the Surface Editor with these. But I do feel like it's pretty close to the effect. I mean, I think you could get away with replicating that effect, and there would only be very slight differences that would be noticeable. I think the collision may be a little bit better on the original effect, but I think for the most part, this is a pretty good replication of that effect. So now, just let it render for a second, just to show you what we get. So, I mean, that's pretty much all there is to the effect. And like I said, there's a ton of different things you can do to change this effect. This was just the basic setup that I wanted to show you guys. So, take care.